This is Fixing KE, a show that invites the public to present solutions to key problems facing Kenya before a panel of judges. Each episode, we ask Kenyans to come up with innovative and effective solutions of addressing pressing issues facing Kenya. On this episode of Fixing KE, we focus on corruption.
I'm hoping to get inspired and hear fresh ideas on how to fight corruption and how we can reclaim back our country from the thugs who are looting everything. So that's why I'm here. I'm excited about this.
I'm really looking forward to meeting young people and seeing the various ideas that are out there, especially looking at new innovations when we talk about corruption, which are some of the major issues in our country. So I'm excited and I can't wait for it.
I'm looking for innovation, I'm looking for enthusiasm, I'm looking for excitement among the people who will be coming to share with us their ideas.
Fixing KE, solutions for Kenya by Kenyans.
My name is Joseph Maina. I think we need to approach corruption not just as a criminal issue. I think corruption should be seen bearing in mind all the dynamics that tie around it. For example, there are the psychological issues involved, and there are the social, there's the social aspect of it, there's also the economic aspect. So besides just looking at it from the criminal science point of it, I think we also need to address or to be sympathetic to the plight of those who engage in corruption.
You think they're sick?
I cannot rule it out.
Okay, so what do you propose we do?
What I'm saying is that it may not be effective in the long run to just look at these people from the lenses of the criminal justice system.
So that is the diagnosis. What is the solution?
The solution, as I said, is to be holistic in the approach. When fighting corruption, we need to keep in mind that those who engage in corruption are, in some cases, victims of the circumstances in which we find ourselves in.
Yeah. You're calling greed a disease?
Yes. I think in our social formation, some of us may be more predisposed to act on the greed that is in every one of us than others.
So can you apply your reasoning to all crimes? Robbery, rapist, murders?
Perhaps we should.
And when we do that, we don't jail them or we make them for them a
even as we jail
a nice
them,
cake?
Even as we jail them, I think we need to be sympathetic to some of the dynamics involved in the formation of these people. It's not anyone's wish to be corrupt. I don't think so.
Joseph, I find it quite... You're saying that the psychosocial understanding
yeah.
context of these people, etc.
Yeah.
And a little bit of what Boniface was asking. So at what point do we start to put individual responsibility and accountability? Because anybody can even blame the devil.
Sure.
Now, the moment you go that route, then everything we can blame on the devil. There's no accountability. So how then will we deal with the scourge of corruption? Or your solution is that these people are just powerless. They are either victims of mental
instability. They are victims of circumstances, yes. They are victims of circumstances.
Explain to me this circumstance that makes some people greedy to the extent of being thieves and others just okay.
Just okay, perhaps because they are not able to or they are fearing to also be part of that gravity train involved. So when we just bound, take people to the jails and lock them up and, subject them to the punishment, we are not addressing the root causes of corruption.
Joseph,
yes.
I'm curious, what do you do?
I'm a scribe.
Ah, okay. And then in your mind, I would just like to understand how you've talked about it being a sickness. What does...
I never said it's a sickness.
Okay, well, yeah. A condition of some sort.
Not a mental. I didn't use the word condition.
A psychological.
Yeah.
the word you use actually is a mental thing.
You said it was.
So
mental.
If it's mental, it's a sickness.
Yeah.
It's an infirmity. It's not like a strength.
Yes.
So if you psychoanalyze someone, it's because they have a problem.
Did I psychoanalyze? I only said that there could be factors beyond what we see as a criminal.
Okay,
or
so
the criminal.
What are those factors?
But I did not ascribe medical terms to it as a condition or something.
Okay, so what does this factor look like to you? Because clearly we've understood it different.
I'm thinking, for example, there are economic dynamics involved.
Okay.
Yeah. If you were to lock all of us in a room for 3 days without food, for instance, and then dangle a bunch of bananas, what do you expect?
Yes, which now goes back to mental health. When you put people in isolation,
it disturbs
with their psychology.
I may not be the authority to ascribe the terms involved to that.
Okay, but
what I'm thinking is, could we talk to psychologists, for example, to tell us, in a situation where there are limited resources, which I think is an economic thing, should we be surprised to see people behaving the way they do in Kenya, for example?
Mm-hmm. So in your mind, I'd like to get into your mind because nobody else seems to understand it.
Mm-hmm.
In your mind right now, let's say we've had a psychologist who comes and meets this person and comes and says, yes, they have a problem. What next?
No, I think the psychologist would tell us that given this set of variables, this is to be expected.
But what next for us? So we've been told that, then what next?
Then we should possibly formulate policies that address that holistically, as opposed to just having Nerima, accused of or convicted of a crime that involves siphoning billions, and then the only panacea to that is to take her to committee, lock her for 10 years or so. Perhaps you're not addressing the issue in its totality. I don't think we are, and I don't think we have people who are articulating it with the required authority.
Okay, thank you.
It's not merely a criminal issue. Yeah, people could be victims of certain circumstances that predispose them to corruption.
So for me, I'm giving you a score, not because of the one that I'm giving you actually, is for the idea. I appreciate your time and your thinking, but I think the idea that you have is very, very wrong. If you go that way, it will mean that any crime will be excused with a psychological, excuse for the crime to happen. I think the best psychological effect you can have on people is punishing them for the crime. In China, they shoot criminals like the ones you have in this country. If you're caught stealing from the people, you're shot dead. So I'll give you a zero, because I detest the idea of actually treating those people as victims. They're not victims, they're criminals.
Okay, Joseph, thank you for your time. For me, I had a hard time understanding your concept, and I think that whenever you have an idea as a vision bearer, it's to motivate or encourage and inspire others to see your idea as well. So the fact that I got lost in the vision in itself, I think that there needs to be more work to be able to articulate in a sense where someone can see themselves in your vision also. And I would say that I give you a 1 for your presentation. Thank you.
Thank you, Joseph, as my colleagues have mentioned, for your time. I think one of the things I really expect out of this place is the extraordinary, the crazy. And I think you're a good manifestation of that crazy in the sense of where we are with corruption. There's a lot of sanitized solutions that we have tried through the years. And I'm remaining very open to listening to quote-unquote crazy ideas. And crazy not in the sense of a mental situation, but things that are out of the ordinary that people discuss when they sit around corruption. And that's why I think you are challenging us to think, so have we spoken to psychologists? Where have we spoken to? I think I'm still committed to having these people punished in one way or another, but I would love a situation where we are going through what you say, a holistic approach. So I am inclined to give listenership to to anything that is out of the ordinary. So that explains my decision to give you a 2.
Having listened to the judges, I would say I'm disappointed by the decision they took, although I'm not surprised. But I still maintain that my contention has always been that corruption is a subject that we should address with facts and possibly from a scientific angle.
Jina langu ni Michael Were Mohosia. Mefika kuzungumzia kuhusiana mambo ya ufisadi. Ufisadi nasema kwamba ni saratani katika Jamhuri ya Kenya na pia vile katika bara la Afrika, lakini katika bara katika taifa la Kenya ni donda ndugu. Manake wengi wanapoteza mwelekeo na tunakosa fedha ambazo zingetumika katika sehemu husika. Zinakwenda ndivyo sivyo, labda pengine kwa mifuko ya watu binafsi. Kwa hiyo ni jambo ambalo kwa mtazamo wangu sio sahihi, na lazima kwa vyote vile wahusika wakuu wote kwa ujumla, inamaanisha kwamba serikali, wananchi wenyewe pamoja na vitengo mbalimbali vya serikali, nazungumzia mahakama na kadhalika, pamoja na bunge, kupigana vikali dhidi ya visa vya ufisadi.
Ukiuliza nafanya wapi, wengi nawaambia niko na KTN, yani Kenya Tamaking Network kwa sasa. Wana kutafuta ajira yani. Kinza zaidi ya yote mimi mwanahabari huru, mbali na hilo pia napania kujiingiza katika kilimo. Lengo kuu naambiwa nipo hapa kwa sababu ya neno moja tu, kuzungumzia kuhusiana na ufisadi. Na sio jambo geni, manake hata sisi baada ya kuzaliwa na tumefikia kimo cha mtu aliye mkamilifu kwa sasa, ni kwamba tumeipata ni sehemu ya maisha. Kwanza siku za Jomo Kenyatta, mingia Moi, akiingia sasa anachukua, nasema atafuata Nyayo, Kibaki akaingia akajaribu kadri uwezo wake, na sasa ni enzi ya Uhuru Kenyatta. Na ni sehemu ya maisha, ni saratani katika maisha yetu, na labda pengine njia mwafaka ipatikane kwa ajili ya tujikomboe kutokana na mambo haya. Sio jambo rahisi, ni jambo ambalo limekita mizizi, manake kwa sasa kwa mfano niseme kiangalia masala ya elimu, wengi wamekosa kuingia shule kutokana na kukosekana kwa fedha, na hata kama shule zipo basi hatuna vyombo maalum vya kutosha, madarasa, madawati na kadhalika. Ukija kwa sekta afya pia vile vile kuna ukakasi kidogo kupata matibabu kikamilifu. Nazungumzia watu ambao wanaugua kutokana na saratani. Kenya tunaweza, iwapo kwa vyote vile fedha tunazozipata tungezitumia vizuri kwa ajili ya kufanikisha ndoto na malengo yetu. Lakini leo hii tuna madaktari, lakini watu wakiwa wagonjwa wanasafirishwa kuelekea kule India kwa ajili ya kupata matibabu, na ni jambo ambalo linatatiza. Ndio tunaweza, lakini tunakwenda kwa taratibu, kwa mwendo ambao ni wa kikonokono. Chamno ni rais wa Jamhuri ya Kenya ambaye yupo kwa sasa mamlakani. Yeye ndiye mwenye uwezo mkubwa, manaka ametuiko majukumu ya kuitendea haki taifa hili. Uwezo anao, kile kinachohitajika pakubwa ni nia, na wale ambao wapo chini yake wamsaidie kadri zao, lakini itakuwa ni atapata ugumu kiasi cha haja. Kisa na maana wapo wahusika wengine ambao pia vile vile wameingia kwenye corruption. Afanye vivyo hivyo alivyofanya Rais John Pombe Magufuli, taifa la jirani la Tanzania. Amejitahidi kadri zake, alirithi mikoba ya ndugu Jakaya Mrisho Kikwete. Kikwete ufisadi ulikithiri, lakini wakati Magufuli alipoanza alikumbana na tetesi, mawimbi ya madhoruba kwa ajili ya kumpinga, lakini akasimama kidete. Kwa sasa angalau kuna utimamu kiasi cha haji inaendelea katika Jamhuri ya Muungano wa Tanzania. Njia mwafaka kupambana na ufisadi, labda pengine inukie dikteta mmoja tu. Na huyu ni mtu ambaye atakuwa na utimamu kwa maana ya kupigania nchi na kuanza upya. Maana system jinsi ilivyo kwa sasa ni kupokezana kijiti, tuendelee na ufisadi. Tumetumia takriban miaka 50 na mambo hayajabadilika. Labda pengine mwingine atajitokeza tu kwa ajili ya kuleta utimamu. Kama si huyo basi dikteta amke, labda pengine wananchi wenyewe amke. Maana kunaambiwa liberators will always emerge. Wanajitokeza wenyewe na kupambania nchi. Yote inawezekana. Kwa namna jinsi ilivyo kwa sasa hali si nzuri. Watu wana kazi, watu wana pesa, mama zetu wanaumia. Hata soko kwa faida bidhaa zetu ni balaa. Kwa hiyo kwa sasa nasema ni vizuri tunaumia ili tujifunze kutokana na upumbavu wetu wenyewe. Ili next time unapoambiwa chagua mwizi na unaenda kuchagua mwizi unajua ni mwizi, ili wewe mwenyewe ujue kwamba umejitwika
kala moto,
ndiye umejitia kitanzi mwenyewe. Kwa hiyo taratibu wenyewe watu wenyewe wamechoka, na nimesema liberators will always emerge.
So hii cancer kama iko kwa kichwa, hii ugonjwa saratani kama iko kwa kichwa, tukate kichwa.
Kama iko kwa kichwa, dawa ya kuna stages za cancer, naambiwa hivyo tuweze kujua, je, ni nani mhusika mkuu. Kama ni huyu mtu ambaye ndiye anahusika, aondolewe tu, hatuna njia nyingine na tuanze upya. Kwa hiyo hatuna cha kupoteza, tutapoteza maisha yetu kwa sasa, lakini kwa faida ya vizazi vijavyo itakuwa ni afadhali. Na naomba kukomea hapo kwa sasa, labda pengine kama kuna mengi ya ziada.
Michael.
Ndio.
Asanteni. Ama asante. Mimi nitajaribu kuongea, sijui kuongea Kiswahili vile wewe unajua kuongea Kiswahili.
Umefanya vizuri. Ndugu yako anapendeza sana.
Nashukuru sana.
Yeah, umefanya vizuri. Ndiyo. So niko na tu swali moja. Umetaja Magufuli kutoka Tanzania, na ukiongea na watu ambao kutoka Tanzania, kuna wengi wanasema kuwa saa zile Magufuli aliingia, haki zao ama zile za demokrasia wanahofia ya kuwa zimeanza kupunguza. Ningependa kujua msimamo wako juu ya ufisadi, kama unapiga ufisadi na wananchi wanasikia ya kuwa haki zao zimepunguzwa, msimamo wako ni upi?
Kila process katika maisha kuna uchungu fulani. Kwa mtoto ambaye ni bikra anapolala na mwanaume, lazima atahisi maumivu. Unapokuja katika kujifungua pia vile vile kuna uchungu fulani. Kwa hiyo in every katika hatua zote zile unazopiga maishani, no pain no gain. Vipi kwa mwalimu Benjamin Mkapa? Atakusifia, na hata nina hakika mwalimu Kambarage Nyerere angekuwa hai leo hii angesema hii ndio filosofia mafalsafa yangu wakati nilikuwa nachukua uhuru, akisema ikulu ni eneo takatifu. Ikulu ni sehemu takatifu, yeyote yule ambaye anabeba Biblia ama na hapa kwa ajili ya kwenda kukaa ikulu aingie pale akijua kwamba anatendea wananchi wa Tanzania haki, kwa maana kuwapatia mazingira tulivu ya kujiendeleza, wasife kutokana na umaskini. Kwa hiyo jiepushe na pressure za ndugu jamaa marafiki na wale wote ambao wanasema ni campaigners wako. Jiepushe nao ukijua kwamba ikulu ni maeneo takatifu. Usiingie kule. Kama hautaweza, wachana nao.
Asante Michael, nimependa sana ulivyozungumzia uwezo bila nia. Ama kwa kweli ukilinganisha ndugu Magufuli aliingia akasema hapa kazi tu. At the same time huku tulikuwa ni hapa wizi tu. Kuna wale wanasema kwa kimombo kuwa if you want to judge the seriousness of an anti-corruption war, there are three things people do. One is the statement of intentions. The statement of intentions. Do we want, what do we say, or what do leaders say they want to do? Number two is the actions we take to realize those intentions. And number three is the results. Kwa kweli nchi hii sijui tuko wapi. Most likely nitaweka katika stage ya kwanza. Ya mwisho, so ukifikiria kujibu hiyo, you've made a call to personal sacrifice. Kila mtu ajitoe mhanga at a very personal level. And I think that is something very interesting. Ningependa uzungumzia kidogo tu, what would that look like? This called personal sacrifice. What are we asking? What are the options? If I say, okay, I'm ready to sacrifice, what does that look like? What actions could I take? If I agree with you that it's time for Kenyans to sacrifice.
Ya kwanza, kuhusiana na mbinu zipi tutumie, ndio. Afrika Kusini walikuwa na utawala wa wale tunaita makaburu kwa muda mrefu. Na baada ya Rais Hosea Madiba Mandela kuchukua hatamu za uongozi, akasema anakwenda kwa awamu moja tu, lakini ndio hawa watu wametukosea pakubwa. Tunaweza anza upya. Na kweli wakaanza upya. Kawa na tume ya maridhiano. Hapa Kenya imekuwa ni ile ya plastic, ile danganya toto, lakini kule kaona tume. Unakumbuka Desmond Tutu na wengine ambao walipigania uhuru wakati huo, na kwa sasa wakasema wacha tufanye kazi kwa pamoja. Lakini baada ya muda mfupi mkora mwingine akaingia, kwa maana ya Jacob Zuma, akasuasua uchumi wa nchi kabla kutupwa pembeni. Kwa hiyo inawezekana. Uhuru ana uwezo, na kile kinachohitajika tu ni kuwa na nia. Kwa sasa yote inawezekana. Uzito wa nchi hii ipo mabegani pake. Kwa hiyo anaweza iwapo kwa vyote vile atataka kupambana nayo. Najua atapata ugumu kiasi cha haja. Na yule anayekwenda kuketi tena baada ya hapo awe ni mtu ambaye pia vile vile ana uwezo mkubwa, nia na uwezo, ndio nia na uwezo wa kupigania katiba nchi. Kila kitu kiende kulingana na taratibu zilizowekwa. Kwa hiyo inawezekana. Hapo nazungumzia nia. Kwa hiyo labda tunaweza anza na Uhuru Kenyatta, naona kwamba huko kuna handshake. Wacha tusubiri tuone kama kweli itazama tunda, lakini isiwe tena na inasalia kuwa hadithi ya Bunwasi kwa mtazamo wangu.
You can actually fight corruption using the rule of law. But Magufuli is very paranoid, but as you conclude, you're supposed to give you points. Tunasemekana kwamba umezunguza vizuri sana na umekuja na idea poa sana, by the way. Wewe ni mtu wa kwanza kukuja hapa saa hii. Umekuja na mikakati ambayo tunaweza chukua kupigana na ufisadi. Kwa hivyo tunakupa alama 3.
Asante.
And that is 3 out of 5.
Asante.
Pongezi.
The highest ever.
Highest from me. Mimi nimekuwa pale 0, 0, 0. So
dictator huyu.
Over here.
Haya basi, Nerima ni kwako sasa.
Yes, pia mimi nimekupatia 3.
Asante.
Yes, nilidhani unajua kuongea vizuri. Yeah.
Tapia mnapoitwa nyinyi ndio baadhi ya watu ambao labda pengine mnatatiza kwenye media, mnapoitwa as experts. Kuna wengine wananiki, okay, siku nyingine.
Wewe unaitwa kama expert.
Analyst, political analyst, CGC. Kuna wengine ni wahuni, anyway, sawa.
Haya. Mwili ni nanaha kwa TV.
Hata ingawa Kiswahili si mdomo changu, nimevumilia kusikia ili nielewe. Umesema vizuri. Nimekupa alama 3 out of 5 as well.
Sante.
Nimeshukuru kwa passion yako. Na uendelee vivyo hivyo.
Asante, nashukuru.
Pongezi.
Asante. Pia kwa muda wenu.
Asante.
Nimefaidi pakubwa ndiyo, na nimejieleza, nimefika pa kujieleza. Kisa na maana, mimi ni mwananchi wa nchi hii, na naamini kwamba sote kwa pamoja, rasilimali zote ni yetu kwa pamoja. The flag, the resources, na kila kitu ni yetu kwa pamoja. Kwa hiyo lazima tuvitunze kwa vyote vile kama mboni ya jicho letu. Wahusika wakuu, nasema kwamba wale majudges, wamejieleza, nilijieleza kikamilifu na wakaniuliza maswali na nikawapa sehemu yao. Lakini zaidi ya yote wamenipa kile kilichostahili kutegemea na hekima walionao wenyewe. Kwa hiyo naridhika nayo.
This is Fixing KE. Stay with us.
Hi. My name is Agnes Maureen. And
Agnes Maureen.
Yes, Maureen. Okay. I am a student at the University of Nairobi. This is my first year. Yes. And looking at our country, we are a poor country, in all honesty. And as years go by, we're not heading towards the right direction. Even at my age, I am young. I know I haven't been around for so long, but even I know we're not headed towards the right direction. And I'm scared. If I leave school, I may not be employed. So what next for me? Do I have to be corrupt like the rest so that I get a way of surviving in society? So one of the ways to help curb corruption is to address the issue of poverty. And notice I used help because I feel the problem of corruption can never be fully solved. And in all honesty, I believe that the Bible is the surest safeguard. Its principles are the only key we have to solving the problem we have now. Thinking of a power that is higher than ours, we can demonstrate, sure, but what next? It will never change the system.
How do you know God exists?
Now is. That is why it's called faith. Faith, believing in the substance of things not seen, and the things hoped for. You have to have a reason to wake up in the morning. I don't know how atheists live. I don't mean to be rude, but you have to have a reason to wake up in the morning, knowing that your life is not in vain at the end of the day. Beyond the scope of this discussion, I ask you to maybe just try read your Bible, because believe me, the Bible is the only faith. I'm 19.
19.
Yes.
When you're 4 years old, I was in Bible school and was a pastor.
No, it's okay. No, no, it's fine. Let me finish. And I'd like to tell you this, even as we probably may never meet again. Yeah, that's like a very high possibility. But I pray you don't forget this, that get the satisfaction from the pursuit of a successful country, a country that is free from corruption. But
and the Bible will help us get that.
Yes, trusting in God, because people are only pious outside. They only have a sense of godliness, but they don't actually accept it. And that is the problem, that we haven't accepted Christ into our lives. And this was not supposed to be a religious discussion. My point was that corruption is a problem that might never end. But I hope you guys and everyone who wants to fight corruption will get the satisfaction out of it. We'll see beyond the failure that we've tried before and we failed. But
both of you seem to have a very nice relationship with God and religion. But allow me to say, Agnes.
Please allow me to say.
This is he attempted to be a pastor. He's no longer a pastor. I think he should know that. So just a moment, just so we don't turn this into a Sunday school. And you don't need to redeem yourself falling by the side of the gospel.
I know.
Having said that, I think, Agnes, if I read you right, the question is, and just speaking from the statement you've just said, is there's a difference between what the person of faith or this Bible or means and says versus church and what we see of the church and as an institution. So perhaps the question is, the church as an institution does not necessarily represent what the vision of true Christianity would have been. So maybe at a personal level, if we had more Christians in Christian institutions, then we could be better. But that is a story for another day. Can I ask you something?
Okay, okay.
You said a statement, and maybe I misunderstood you. Corruption can't be totally
eradicated. Yes.
That sounds quite fatalistic, defeatist. So that is my first question. Enable me to understand that. Number two, would you be bothered about corruption today if I assured you that upon graduation you will have a job?
Would I be bothered? In all honesty, let me answer the second one, then the first one. In all honesty, as a Kenyan, I really wouldn't be bothered that much. Corruption becomes a bother when you're the victim to it. Because how many people out there that know corruption as a story and not as an experience, and now want to fight it when they become the victims and the defeatist? No, I said help. Curb corruption, because we can try, and it will take us a very long way. At least it will help Kenya be a little less awful as it now is.
The devil is a myth. Have you seen him?
He's not a myth.
Hiya.
He's not.
I go to church, but
he's not a myth. And believe me, let you me will just, see. He's
when,
not.
When
a
I get
myth.
To where? To heaven or hell?
No, you won't get to any place in the final judgment. Where will I see the devil? See him. Ati?
Where will I see the devil?
Wait for the resurrection.
I've given you a two for your passion, but let me tell you, the Bible has nothing to do with the corruption in this country. And the people who are still in this country, all of them are born again. Ask them.
But the Christianity is not true.
Their Christianity is not true.
Yeah, it's not true Christianity.
Okay. Mahatma Gandhi said this. I love you, Jesus, but I don't like your Christians.
Okay.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, Agnes. For me, I think that you have a persona that's very calm. And even though it got a little bit heated, you would not even be able to tell. And I think that's a strength in itself. And I wanted to ask, but I felt like it was dragging on too long. I actually don't know what your solution was. If it was put in a sentence.
Pray.
I don't know.
Yes, that is the solution. We need prayer.
To pray. Yes. Okay.
She was sleeping through your wonderful presentation.
I gave you two.
I don't buy that. For your passion,
it's okay, it's okay.
Uh-huh. And your prayer battalion, and whatever which I wish you uh-huh. well for, mm-hmm. I gave you a whooping two, which I can't justify still. So I'll keep thinking in my head why I gave you two. But mm-hmm. yeah, I don't think prayers falls anywhere there.
And it's okay. The judges were interesting. Yeah, they gave interesting feedbacks. Yeah, they were awesome. Yeah, so good. In general, I feel like this is a good platform for me to be able to give my opinion as a Kenyan citizen on what I think on the issues that do challenge us. And yes, I do agree, corruption is a big problem in Kenya that needs to be addressed and addressed as soon as possible. My name is Fiona Odhiambo.
Okay.
Yeah, I work in risk management and I'm here to give some few inputs on what I think and how I feel we could address this issue of corruption. So for me, the way I look at corruption is something of a different perspective in that I see it as a sort of a learned behavior. This is something that we've grown up and we've learned it and we've put it accustomed to our daily routine that has made life either easier for you, depending on how you see it or depending on your perspective. So for me, my solution to deal with this issue would be to unlearn it, as simple as that. Let's put things in place that can enable us to unlearn the terrible behaviors that we've learned over time because of society influences or because of the circumstances we found ourselves in. And the only solution to get out of that circumstances has allowed you to practice corruption.
Thank you, Fiona. I just have a question. When you talk about unlearning, are there repercussions in your solution?
Mm-hmm.
What are the consequences? Okay. Are there any? Because it's very easy, for instance, we follow the law because we are afraid to go to jail.
Yes.
Or we follow the law because there is something that we are fearing to cross.
I think it's because you have to go down to understanding this, the consequences and the impact of corruption. That would be the first step. Of course, for my solution, we were talking about, we already know what corruption is. We understand it, we understand the implications. Now we're ready to change. That is where my solution comes in.
How I teach my kids to behave themselves is that if they misbehave, there's consequence for their actions.
Mm-hmm.
And then they're gonna not watch TV, or they will not go outside to play, or they won't be able to ride their bicycle. Now what they're telling us is just let us learn that it is wrong to be corrupt. If you walk around this entire city, you'll see signs saying these are corruption-free zone.
Yeah.
There are stickers everywhere, but you still bribe. And what she's trying to tell you, the truth is, if there's no consequence for your corrupt activities, things will change. So today, Kenya is poorer not because of the 50 bob that the cop got in the street, because of high-level corruption.
Mm-hmm.
So how are you going to teach the ministers and the president and the deputy president and the magistrates and the judges and the senior government officials that corruption is bad and they should stop? What is that incentive for them to stop from stealing from us?
Integrity. It has to be a personal decision. We all want to believe we are people of integrity. Nobody wants to go and stand there and say, I am the one person who likes to give bribes and I do it and this is my honor. No one wants to do it. It has to come from the individual, which is why I think this has to be also a personal decision. You can instill all the information you want to instill to anybody, but in that moment, it comes down to your decision making. And I feel like this is where we have the opportunity, where we can teach people how to work through these decision processes.
So what would be radical enough? We are looking for the radical, the out of the box, not praying for them, not weighing them into, it's the devil. I'm looking for something really, like, something we haven't tried or we haven't done enough of.
Change people's minds.
At gunpoint?
No.
Okay.
What is your persuasion tool?
Yeah, like walk me through this. Laying of hands and prayers, gunpoint, call a council of... What is it that...
I mean, even if you put a gun into my head and I still believe what I've done is right, you're not changing me.
I'm going to pull the trigger. You'll die.
It's okay. I'm dead.
And then the other people will see you dying and they say, when that guy actually summons okay. you next time, you don't want to mess
up. We have thieves who get killed in robbery. Has it stopped all the thieves out there?
Do you know the biggest corrupt people in this country fear death? That's the reason why they have bodyguards, they live in big houses, they actually live a very secluded life from the public. You know why? They want to live longer to enjoy what they have stolen.
Mm-hmm.
The man who's stealing a phone in the village actually knows that he may die tomorrow. He has no future, no hope.
Fiona, I'm just lost. Are you bothered by the levels of corruption in this country?
I am bothered by the levels of corruption, yes.
Am I allowed to ask how old you are?
I'm 26.
26. Life expectancy, depending on whom you ask, is anything between 55 and 63.
Uh-huh.
So assuming we took 55, how many more years do you have?
Not a lot.
You're basically at your midpoint.
Exactly.
Are you satisfied by our fight against corruption? Does it give you hope that actually before you become very dead, there will be no corruption? There will be no futures being lost. There will be no women dying because somebody stole their maternity fee, monies for maternity, and people will not be pretending to run on beyond zero while they are dining in the evening with the same thieves who are making maternity inaccessible. Do you get that feeling that when you die, Kenya will be better than what it is now because we are fighting corruption?
Not at the moment, because I still think that the mindset of the people who are fighting corruption is still not right.
It's score time. I think I'll give you a 1 for your effort in your presentation.
Mm-hmm.
I would have actually given you a 0 because I don't believe in what you said.
Okay.
But for your effort in presenting, you have my 1.
Okay, Fiona, for me, I think that you are standing on your point. You completely stood firm on your point. And I believe that you actually were, I think, the briefest. You are very brief and straight to the point with your articulation, which I think also is good, and I give you a 2.
When I went to school, art and craft was a core requirement. So I've rusted over the years, so I'm trying to beautify my score.
It looks like it's an oval.
So, Fiona, thank you for sparing the time. I am not persuaded that you see the urgency of now, and I don't think, and it is not particularly unique to you, I don't think that many Kenyans have grasped where we are. There's a joke given 2 days ago about somebody said we are in a revolutionary moment in this country. The revolution will come, but something terrible needs to happen because until we hit the rock bottom. And in a moment of Heineken-inspired wisdom,
mm-hmm.
I said we actually can't hit the rock bottom because even the rock, if the bottom has been stolen, so we are on free fall. And I don't think most Kenyans realize where we are at this point.
Mm-hmm.
And therefore, I don't see that urgency in you. I see the prayers, the woye, where the criminals become the victims, and that doesn't inspire me. I'm still looking in this platform. The extraordinary, the crazy that makes you go like, I gave you a whooping 2.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Good luck.
Thanks. Mazisi, unapenda 0?
Mimi?
Yeah.
No, because me, I want to be inspired and I want to inspire.
I want to be inspired too, and I really feel frustrated a little
so
bit.
So why should I appease them? I'll just give you your L.
There's effort. You see, I think part of this is there's a way in which I see it as a two-way as well. It's a learning as well, and the way we challenge them, we are not necessarily putting them on the fire because it's their fault. But I think it's an opportunity to stretch their imagination, pull them to places they don't see. Not all will. So I'm a little sympathetic to making them feel something I said matter. And if they left feeling that they've been pushed a little bit, I think I'm home. So I would struggle with a 0 on any contestant. I know. That's just me.
You're kind with the score.
The feedback from the judges, I felt were quite valid. They did have a strong point on against my arguments. However, I feel like they were quite heavily based on solutions we need to do now and not for solutions we need to work towards in the long term to be able to come up with a solution that is lasting.
My name is Edmund. You can call me Eddie. I'll really appreciate. So today, I just want to talk honestly about corruption on a very, very, very honest side. Kuongeka kama youth, tangawa youth man, mwenye natoka mwenye moja kurepresent ma youth wale wengine nyanya hizi fika mali kama hapa kuongelea history. Actually, sahi corruption vile nikona fikiria, corruption sahizi imekama ikakuwa something it's a natural disaster, imekuwa natural disaster. Sahizi unaweza hapa Kenya you can place corruption pamoja na AIDS na cancer kwa sababu ni kitu inatumaliza sahizi unconsciously bila si kujua. But okay, si tukijua, yani inatumaliza tukijua, but ni kitu nyataki ku accept that inatumaliza. But kwa historia yote, the people who I really blame most personally ni the so-called millennials, ama nitawaita the middle class. Ando majama wenye wako na manpower, the people who can make things happen in this country, and yo wengi, and they control a lot in this country. But tukenda kuongea historia ya corruption, unapata ndo watu wenye wanataka kujifanya mazee history ndio tunaongelea, but they really okay, they want to talk about it, but they don't want to tackle it by the horns. Wataki kuiface hiyo corruption vizuri kwenye ukisikia tumeita demonstration ku demonstrate against sema corruption some MPs nini, unapata the middle class kwa ofisi ma Facebook ma Twitter ndio zao, lakini ule mwenye anapigana kwa street, ule mwenye anarusha mawe kwa street, ule okay si kurusha mawe generally that's violent, but ule mwenye kwa street mwenye anapiga kelele kwa street na demonstrate ni ule mama wa mboga ametolewa Kibera, ametolewa Kariobangi, ametolewa huko Mathare, ina na come street kwa sababu pengine amepromisiwa na mama activist we come tutapatia punch, tutapatia 500 kuja demonstrate. But kuna ule mtu mwenye ameenda shule vizuri, ule mwenye ako na hiyo man power, ule mwenye ako na power ya simu, ako na power ya kuongea, anaweza jet kile tu vizuri, yeye ndio hapo hivyo, hakuna kile anasaidia wa Kenya wengine nayo. So yeye ikaza kini kukana ma Facebook na ma Twitter. Hizo ma Twitter zitusaidie at this point in this country. What we need in this country right now is actions. Na hiyo action I happen over online or social media.
Eddie, how old are you?
I am 27.
27.
Yeah.
You got a story jo? Like yeah. What is your big idea?
My big idea ni kwamba we need out to your wadogo, yani tuseme kama uko na watu, tuseme kama uko na watu wadogo, tuseme 3 year old. Wewe mwenyewe personally inafuanze kufundisha watu hii wakigrow up, unafuanze kuwafundisha corruption ni mbaya. So wakigrow up wanagrow up mentality wanajua corruption is bad. So unajua dadi alitufundisha hii na hii ni mbaya. So hata kabla afike 27 kama mimi atakuwa amegrow up akijua this thing is bad. Na hapo hivyo tutakuwa tumefanya very tutakuwa tume save a lot of things at that time.
Kwa hivyo namaanisha kwamba watu ni corrupt sasa hivi, vijana ni corrupt sasa hivi kwa sababu ni corrupt juu ya corruption ni mbaya.
Ni kwa sababu wamegrow up na hiyo aspect ya corruption unconsciously. So hizo corruption ndogo hizo tiny corruption ndio zina build up na kuja zinakuwa kitu kubwa. Watu wanaanza kubamba 21 billion.
Kwa sure?
Eh, niko sure. Hiyo ni yangu, niko sure nayo.
Thank you again, Eddie. As I was saying, you had represented a picture of really what a crisis the question of corruption has become for this country, and I think few would disagree with you.
Mm-hmm.
But coming to what you propose as one of the way forward in dealing with this, you propose that we would look at basically an education, kind of a socialization of the young generation.
Mm.
And if you think of a generation as a 20, anything, to get over one generation, you're looking about 20, 25 years. Given the picture of a crisis that you have painted, are you proposing that we just we tolerate the crisis as it is, and we wait for the next generation, this 3 year, 5 year old, whom we start to educate and socialize in new ways?
If that's the case, then I'd propose that, because ukiangalia vizuri, from the Nyayo era, yeah, you can even find some headlines back in 1970 something. Headline nakwambia, President so and so trying to fight corruption, blah blah blah. The same story, but unapiga saizi. So that means this same nini methods we've been using since 1970s has jawak for all those years. Saizi ni 2019.
Okay, I have a question for you, Eddie.
Yeah.
When you were talking, you blamed a lot on the middle class. Youth, millennials, in fact.
Yeah.
But if we look at young people, below the age of 35, most of us are not even middle class. In this country, it's those who earn above 40,000 a month. Very few youth fit in that bracket. So technically, the group of people you're talking about are a handful in an ocean. It's a drop in an ocean. But my next question is, how do you feel if we encourage youth not to practice corruption, children, what would incentivize them? Because you've talked about how terrible corruption is, but what's the good of not having corruption? What if children don't see a benefit? There are no rewards for those who do well in this country. So what are some of the methods you'd use to encourage children to not practice corruption?
The same way you've been rewarding your kids when they perform well in school.
So my feedback to you, you made a lot of assumptions. The reason why I give food to my kids and I pay their school fees, I'm not bribing them, it's my commitment to them. So it's not like, nikofundisha mambo ya corruption ni mbaya, I'm corrupt, I change their ways. Because kids actually don't care what you say, they care what you do. So you made a lot of assumptions. And then everything that you quoted and said was not based on facts. Come to me, Kenya Bureau of Standards, Kenya Data, something says this or that, or the last census, or ECC report. So my first score for you was zero. But because you made some effort, it's one because you're standing there. But if you actually want to win the war against corruption and become a leader in your community, you need to read more and understand things that you're talking about.
Gracias.
For me, Eddie, I want to say thank you for your time. I think that you had many ideas, but it lacked a flow of the ideas. So perhaps to put them on paper and then also to be more specific, because there were different perceptions and understandings. And also, you're extremely confident, but also to also take time to listen to advice and also perhaps questions to think deeper into your concept. So for me, I give you a 2, and I think that there's more room for improvement for you.
Thank you, Eddie. I like your passion on the corruption, anti-corruption scope. Definitely, it's a catch-22. We find ourselves in this country, so there are no easy solutions. I think your weakest point, according to me, was there was too much diagnosis of the problem. I think we need to spend as little time as possible on what the problem is and move as fast as possible into what the solution could be. So at one point, you lost me on that. For your effort and your passion, I awarded you a score of 2.
Thank you. So, thank you, boys.
Very much.
2 judges were fair to me. And then one judge, I think, had he had a mindset, let me say that. I think he only thinks his ideas are the ones to be implemented peke yake. He doesn't think about other people's ideas. That is what I think about him, but alinipatia kawan ni sawa.
Fixing KE, solutions for Kenya by Kenyans.